Now I'd like to introduce Chris Muscovites, who is our final presenter for today. Please welcome him.
Thank you. First of all, before I start, I want to thank Marguerite and I want to thank the board for inviting me to speak to you tonight. It is particularly special for me because I frequently have the opportunity to speak with our company's board of directors, executive teams, even staff. But this is special. This is very special for me because I'm actually addressing colleagues. And that is really important. This is something that I take very seriously. The intellectual capital in the room alone. You folks have forgotten more than I know easily any time of the week. So it is a real honor for me to be here. So I wanted to start with that and acknowledge you all and how proud I am to be able to address you. And I also want to again thank the board of Osaka, New York for inviting me and also give them a hand along with the volunteers for putting up an incredible event. So, thank you, sir. And I know how much time it takes to put all of these events together, and this is not easy. So, I also was asked when do I want to have the talk, and I said I would like to be the last speaker. And I wanted to be the last speaker because it gives me an enormous amount of power. I am the only one standing between you and happy hour. So, how about that election, huh? Now, on the board you see what the agenda for the talk is and what I plan to do. And I think that I am going to take a slightly different approach. The title of the talk, How I Stopped Worrying and Went to Love Hackers, A Pragmatic Guide to a Cybersecurity Program, of course is outrageously misleading, right? Because everybody is a professional here, you understand that creating a cybersecurity program is not something that can be covered in 90 minutes. So, out of the gate, this talk is going to have to address something very, very different. The second thing is that this is the title of my upcoming book, which I am very eager to wrap up and finish because the publisher is on my tail to make that happen by January. But more importantly, because my second book is the one that I really want to put out, and that's the book about privacy. And let me tell you, that's just going to be hours of an interactive one. One apology before I go over. You notice that I'm spending most of my time looking at this group over here. This is not because you're deplorable. It is because I'm just really stiff over here, so I apologize for that. So, what we're going to talk today is we're going to talk about why cybersecurity programs, especially in the mid-market North space, are not getting the traction that they should be. So in a sense, and that's why I have program development adoption failing, in a sense, we as risk people, and in essence, the crowd here, be it in IT, be it in cybersecurity, be it in audit or compliance or straight-up risk, we are risk people. This is what this is about. We understand this, we also understand the clear and present danger, we understand the technologies behind it, we understand all of these things. We have been attempting to communicate all of these things in a variety of ways. And under the best of circumstances, we have been getting either lip service or we have been getting some degree of action that has been going on. And we keep raising the rhetoric. We keep raising the tone. We have an issue. We need to address it. You, board of directors, you are responsible for this. They are going to hold you off in handcuffs. Okay? You can pay attention to this. And we're getting yeah. And depending on where you are, what kind of company you're dealing with, If you are under regulatory scrutiny, you are more likely to gain traction in these things. But if you're not, you are like, yeah, I get it. We got to do this, and I'm on you. And you get this not quite pushback, but it's a tone down. It's a tone down, and the adoption is not what we want it to be. And this is manifests itself a great deal with how budgets get allocated, with how staff gets hired, with how programs get rolled out, and so on and so forth. So this is the particular interest and to me. So, being that this audience is risk professionals, what is our duty, what is our responsibility in shifting that rhetoric? Because whatever it is that we're doing so far, not so much. I mean, we have some degree of success, but really not so much. So something is going on. So let's start with a question. Okay? Ask yourself a question. Okay? Is fear useful? Now, but when I used to wake up without aids and pains, I used to teach in a two-year college in upstate New York. And it was a two-year technical school. I used to teach computer science. My background is physics, computer science, mathematics, and then some graduate work in organizational management and so on. So the crowd that I used to teach in the two-year school, as you can imagine, was fairly urban, and it was, a rough and tumble crowd, So I used to walk into my classes and I used to say, I am a firm believer of fear as a valid educational tool. And we established some narrative going from that. But is this working? Is this working at the level of us, at the level of our profession? Is this working? I can tell you that it is not working. It's not working at the board level, it's not working at the executives, it's not even working straight up at the consumer level. Anna, my partner in life and in crime and in the business, was talking with Heredit or at Wiley. And she was saying, Chris has this cybersecurity book, blah, 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 blah. And the editor of Wiley goes like, no mas. I don't want to talk about cybersecurity. I don't want to talk about this book. I don't want to talk about cybersecurity. We are not publishing any cybersecurity stuff. Like, why? Well, because you people, have destroyed the subject. You keep going around and saying, well, there's two kinds of companies. Those that have been hacked, and those that don't know what have been hacked. Thanks. This is useful. So nobody's reading this stuff. Everybody has gone tone deaf every day in the papers and so on and so forth. You know the drill. So fear, in this particular case, doesn't appear to be a valid educational tool. Okay? We know that. Because we keep telling to our board, we keep telling to the executives that we have to do all of these things. We have a clear and present danger, but nothing is happening. Why is this the case? Why is this not working? These people are reasonable people. They are running companies, they are running teams, they are running all these things. This is not your average dumb crowd. Okay? But it's failed. I think I know why. It's failing because fear turns into despair. It's failing for the exact same reason the editor at Wiley would not publish another book. They don't want to publish another book, and the executives don't want to hear about this anymore. Because it doesn't resonate with them. They're not buying into the narrative, okay? So they're not buying into the narrative, and this is translating itself into our world immediately, okay? How is this still a thing? This just recently for Spiceworks, mid-market companies. How is this still a thing? When every single day across any medium that you can pick, there is a breach, there is a problem, there is guides, there is frameworks, there is conferences, there is a whole industry surrounding it, but this is still a thing. And we keep hearing the same words over and over again. Risk is not sexy. Prevention is not a thrill, it's just not, I would much rather build a new bridge than, repair one. It's much sexier to cut the ribbon, but it's not as sexy as to repair the bridge. Audit, necessary evil. These audit people, seriously? If I could do without them audit people? You don't want to talk about regulations. Regulations, who needs the regulations? We don't need a stinking regulation. Let the market decide. We know exactly what is going on here. Everything is a big waste of time and money. That's what's going on. That is what we hear about. But this is not the truth. Some of it has to do with this. Everybody, I'm pretty sure, is familiar with this. And I think that we are in the blue dot. I think we are in the depression dot when it comes into cybersecurity programs. Across companies, certainly in the mid-market space, like we discussed earlier. So this is despite all the news coverage, despite all the propaganda, despite everything, this is where we're at. I think we find ourselves in this depression mode. And now we have an opportunity. We have a unique opportunity. We have an opportunity to change our narrative. Okay, we have an opportunity to change the conversation. And we can change the conversation because cybersecurity is finally starting to emerge, not as a technology problem, which, by the way, it isn't. It isn't anymore. Healthcare is a doctor problem. It isn't. It is a holistic view of a whole discipline. Cybersecurity is a people problem. And if we can grab onto this reality and change that narrative, we will go way further, I assert. And I'm going to walk you through this, why I think that that would be the case. So, one of the weapons that we have is finally, cybersecurity is bringing together in complete alignment IT, risk, and audit. It is probably one of those rare instances where all of these disciplines are getting together and handshaking together very well. We need one another. So all of a sudden, you have IT professionals, cybersecurity professionals, audit, risk managers, actually sitting down and talking to one another freely and openly. And IT people saying to audit people, I need you. I need you to have my back. Find out what I blew here. Cybersecurity people trying to understand this everyday battle and everyday war. It is, in a sense, a high tide. The cybersecurity events that have been happening over the past few years represents a high tide in those service areas. And these service areas are represented in here tonight. And it is these same service areas that can change the narrative in our organizations. Okay? Otherwise, if we're talking about the cybersecurity program, we can have this conversation over very, very quickly. Miss CSF and COVID. Thank you, good night. But this is not what's going on here. We have a different obligation. We have a different conversation that we need to have. So we have an opportunity to end the us versus them narrative in our organizations. And that means changing our role a little bit. Okay? And I need to take a step back here and explain this. Just as I used the example of medicine, the same applies in our services. Our services are a broad spectrum. There are surgeons. There are people that are in the trenches every day that are dealing with a specific denial of service attack, and they're configuring firewalls, and they're doing incredible surgical things that help the cause. Equally important, there are audit people that have a regulatory view. Equally important are risk people that have all sorts of different views, cybersecurity managers. It is a spectrum. So when I'm saying, let's change our role, it's not trying to take a surgeon and trying to make the surgeon an internist. That's not going to work. There's a reason why this person chose to be a surgeon, it's because they're very good at it. So don't try to make a giraffe into a lion. That doesn't work, that never works. But framing the problem in a people frame changes the conversation, because now you're talking about healthcare in a very different way. You're not talking about this surgeon is going to configure a firewall, and the minute that you say that to a board of directors or to an executive, you get that wonderful, wonderful glaze, and then you're lost. That's it. You don't get the CISO trying to make a presentation into a board, having a conversation about that, and again, you get the that wonderful eye of the look of the cow. Whatever you say, how much is it going to cost? Okay. That's not what we want to do here. Okay, that's our opportunity. But as with every opportunity, I'm talking to my peeps, there's risk. And part of the risk is that it always takes two to tango, no matter what it is that we do. And we have a tremendous responsibility to change the narrative, and I think we have the initiative to do that. It does always take two to tango, and we have to be met halfway. There is no way, no matter what it is that we do, if you are continuously facing a brick wall. And that's not what I'm asking you to do. I am not asking you to go up to any board, any executive, anyone, ever, and keep banging your head against that brick wall, trying to shift your thinking, if you're not being met halfway. No. For those kind of executives, for those kind of boards, I'm not worried. They're like the dinosaur. That's exactly right. If they themselves don't recognize the need to change the narrative and the need to engage in a different way, I'm not worried. The meteorite is coming. We're good. You don't have to worry about it at all. So we are the catalyst for development. We are the catalyst of development and support of cybersecurity in our organizations. And there is a beautiful thing that we are looking at in our profession now that in essence really differentiates the way we used to do business. Because our profession, if you will, and I'm speaking in generalities here, tends to be isolated. You know the famous thing, IT is in the dark room, you know, there's blinking lights, we just throw them raw meat, the stuff keeps working, we're good. Okay? But now, not only is IT recognizing the value of audit, not only is cybersecurity recognizing the value of corporate risk function, but we all need one another. So all of a sudden, we're coming out of the dark rooms and starting to have conversations along our layer, and because we need one another, we're stronger for it. We can now approach this conversation and communicate this issue in a better way. We can start coming out of the shadows. We can start talking about these issues in a different way.
Risk. Risk is our business.
Remember that? Many years ago. Risk is our business. And we need to be proud of the fact that we are uniquely qualified to turn our business into an incredible asset across all of our organizations, across all of the disciplines that we touch. And in order to do that, we are going to succeed by not us developing a cybersecurity program, but by having the organization develop a cybersecurity program. And in order for that to succeed, we need to act as mentors, we need to act as teachers to the organization. We need to engage them exactly like a teacher would engage a student, exactly like a mentor would engage a mentee, exactly how a doctor would engage a patient that has a holistic view. And if music is your thing, you would engage them exactly like a conductor. Not the first violin that you have been so far, and an expert first violin, but as a conductor. And the goal would be to step back and have everybody write and start playing their own music. That's going to be very important. As I said, change the culture from within. If we are unable to change the culture from within, nothing's going to happen. It's not about how to get married. And by that I mean, it's not about winning the budget battle. It is not about trying to prepare the deck that has 800 slides that justifies the new IDS. That's not what's needed here. It's not about how you get married. It's about how you get to stay married. And that's not as easy. And coming from somebody that has had three wives, I can assure you. I speak from experience. I am also not running for president. Everything is about perception. And it's certainly not about how we are seen. And that's fine. But it is very much how everybody else in the organization sees themselves. We have keep talking internally about how important it is for everybody to recognize that cybersecurity is a shared responsibility. We know that. All of this information is being ingrained in us as professionals in the field. We know the drill. We know that board has to have buy-in and top-level support. We know all of these things. We have the framework. We know all of that kind of stuff. But what does it mean? How do you actually do this? How exactly? No. I mean, stop the conversation. How? I want to know how. I mean, this is a cultural war. It's a people issue. And this is the kind of stuff that we need to address. It's about how everybody else sees themselves in relation to one another. And to do this, we need to change their perception of what it's worth, okay? And this is why. The why is because we live in a world that everybody has turned into survival mode. We're drinking off an information fire hose every single day. And of course, we have precious. Precious with the blue light. See here. Precious. This is part of the issue. The information flood is not only on us, which to some degree or another, at least we are trained and qualified to deal with. I question to what degree we are successful, but at least you would expect that in the profession, you know how to do this. But look outside the window. Look at all these executives, middle managers, everybody out there. They're in a torrent. They're white water rafting, and these guys don't even know how to swim. And we're trying to change culture, we're trying to change values in somebody that's, you know, careening down the white water, trying to keep the black side of the boat still on the downside. This is not an easy proposition. This is not an easy proposition at all. So, but that's our goal. This is what we need to do. So in order for us to do that, we are going to have to solicit, train, and engage with executives that otherwise would not normally look to do this. To make that happen, we are going to have a conversation that is about what's of value to them. To make that happen, we're going to have to set down a common language. We're going to have to explain what the hell, excuse the language, we're talking about. So I'm going to walk you through a set of slides now of presentations that I have used in the past with various stakeholders at various levels in order to set a level field of what it is that we're talking about. It is my expectation that you will be bored silly, because you should know all of this if you don't see me at the end of the presentation. So, what is cybersecurity, right? We know all about this wonderful stuff. Last June, I think, there was a Gartner Summit down in Washington, D.C. I don't know if any of you were there or not, or if any of you have ever been in a Gartner Summit. Gartner puts a big show. Really, like a big show, lights, the whole bit. It's very, very theatrical. Compare this to CSX 2016. I just came from Las Vegas on the Psyche CSX, and it was an incredible conference, And if you have the chance to do that next year, because it's going to be in DC, you must go. It is one of the best conferences in the field, okay? Part of the reason is because different stakeholders will come up and just say, you know what? This is part of the reason why this is such a great conference. Nobody trying to sell you stuff. It is real professionals giving you real value. But back to Gartner. So Gartner added some, well, you know, they do useful stuff. I do like Gartner. I'm going to pony up and go to the next one. And it is money. They added this thing. And so, you know, we tend to be proprietary with confidentiality, integrity, and availability. So somebody starts throwing other words around, it's like, really? I'm not so sure about that. Discuss that. The safety thing is covered already. So, and this is pilfered from the slides, I'm saying. So they said, listen, confidentiality, integrity, and availability applies to data. Safety applies to environments and people. So in essence, they're expanding the framework to include IoT now, and the direct effect that cybersecurity actually has to environments and living things. And this is a valid point. So I think it's an important thing for all of us to have a conversation about, and we see some of its effects on a daily basis. So the rest, I trust, we all are familiar with. The attacks, the kinds of attacks, the kinds of agents behind the attacks. And these are things that all of a sudden, when you're having a conversation with an executive, typically the way that I would do this is I would bring a group or a business unit together and have a similar presentation with them. They get very fascinated when they see things like trade secrets, espionage, hacktivists, all of these kinds of things all of a sudden become interesting. And this is where you can start laying the foundation of this common language. You start explaining about attacks, the different ways that attacks happen. What does it mean? What's going on? What's going on with cybercrime? Why is ransomware so prevalent? What exactly is happening in our world? Why do they need to know all of these things? And all of a sudden, people are starting to learn more and more and more about things. You start explaining the specifics of malware, the Trojans, all of the different things. And they start, you're taking advantage now of the fact that this information has been so buzzed about that it's starting to resonate in their head. And once they have somebody that they can now engage and have a conversation about, it becomes reachable. It's like, oh, I see. So this ransomware thing, you know, it's like Billy Bob is doing this because he wants $300. Well, Billy Bob is stupid. Yes, Billy Bob is stupid. But other people are not. Sergey is not. So you start explaining about cyber attacks, advanced persistent threats, and then you have an honest conversation with everybody around the room about where they are in the food chain. And this is part of the pragmatic cybersecurity program conversation. All of this information is very nice, and even within our own field, you have to take stock of where you are. Not all things apply to all companies. Not all things apply to all individuals. So you can have a conversation now with a business unit or with the organization and say, well, where do you think you fall? Do you think that our company is likely to be a victim of a nation state? Do you think that we have IP worth protecting? What do you think are some of the issues that we need to be looking at? All of a sudden, the conversation now is being had outside of this room. You're bringing people in and they're starting to expand their mind and starting talking about things that is not part of the day-to-day. Part of the reason they're talking about that is because it is of value to them. And we're going to go into explaining that about how we do that. Everybody obviously knows about business impact analysis, but if we turn business impact analysis on its head, then we can make business impact analysis about them and have them conduct the business impact analysis. Remember, you're the conductor. Let them be the first priority. So, risk, no. Can you measure the risk? No. Risk is mitigated, no. And of course, zero risk is the cost of doing business. Now, the most interesting thing about this is that last line. Residual risk is the cost of doing business. Immediately now, you have a group of business people, yeah, residual risk is the cost of doing business. I get that. I make that decision every day. You start having a conversation about the decision that you make every day. Well, what do you mean by that? Explain that to me. Well, you know, I'm looking at an accounts payable spreadsheet. I'm going to have to like prioritize this, that, and the other, and I'm going to pay Bob and not pay Mary. Or different things. One of the things that I'd like to bring up when I'm talking to risk, especially if I'm with a crowd that they are either risk averse or don't quite relate to the decision making about risk, is this. Number one, we make risk decisions every single day. Every single day, every individual on the planet makes a risk decision. You may not be conscious about it, but you make a risk decision the minute that you wake up in the morning. Okay? And the example that I use is, you're with friends, you're at the bar. It's 11 o'clock at night, you're getting out of the bar, and you look left, there's no car coming. You look right, there's a car about a block and a half away, the light is against you, do you or do you not cross the road? And 100% of the people say, absolutely, I cross the road. I'm like, what, you're kind of crazy? Like, I'm crossing the road. I'm not waiting. I'm in New York. Mm-hmm. I'm like, huh? Okay, great. I say, so now, you're out to dinner, same group of friends, but you brought your partner with you, and you also brought your baby, who's in a stroller, because you couldn't find a babysitter. It's 11 o'clock at night. You go out on the street. You have the stroller. You're holding the stroller. You look left, no car. You look right, there's a car down the block. The light's against you, do you cross the street? All of a sudden, people are starting to get what it means to manage risk. And this changes the tone. This changes the conversation that you're going to be able to have about what's acceptable risk within their own business unit. You are this far away from happy hour. Stay focused. All right. Now, you are going to need to do some homework. And this is the part of the role-changing bit that I was talking to you about earlier. Remember, I am not suggesting, even remotely, that a surgeon become an internist. But I am suggesting that you're going to have to meet everybody else halfway in order to succeed. So internally, start taking stake and asking some questions. Where are you? What is the business that you're in? What is going on there? Understand the business. Don't just show up and collect the paycheck and do surgery. What do you do? I do surgery. What does that mean? I show up, I do the firewall, I leave, I get a paycheck, I'm good. Okay. Now we want to change this narrative a bit. So where do you work? A bank? No. That's not okay. We need to start getting a better understanding of what work means, where you're at. I am using the Smithsonian because it happens to be, I did quite a bit of research in obviously putting this book together, and in the book there's like a dozen mission and vision statements. Out of all of them, I have to tell you, and I went with no profits because that's the easiest thing to do. So the Smithsonian have the clearest mission and clearest vision statements. They're on point, accurate, this is what we want, and this is how we're going to get it. And I urge you to do the same thing in the environment that you're in. Where are you going to find it? Okay, try the annual report. If you don't have an annual report, start looking at the employee manual. It's typically page 2. If you don't have an employee manual, then you're in the lone wolf, and if you don't know what your mission and vision statement is, you have no government. Okay? So think about that. Make sure that you understand where you are. What are you doing? Now, in our business, Anna runs the software division, and the software division builds large transactional software. And I'm going to name drop. One of our clients is Kellogg, and we, for the past 17, 18 years now, have been running the Girl Scout quick sale. So if any of you have young daughters and have been buying, you know, the Fitments and all that stuff, our software is behind that. So Anna has had the opportunity to talk to a lot of nonprofits as they roll out all of these different kinds of software and applications. And one of the things that the director of a nonprofit told her once, very wisely, it's like, no money, no mission. And this applies to the nonprofit world, and it applies very well into the for-profit world. Understanding where you're at, your mission and vision statements are very, very important. The no money, no mission is this word pragmatic that keeps sticking in front of cybersecurity and in front of all us. You have to keep that in mind. You need to remain pragmatic. This is not some theoretical exercise. This is very real, okay? So you need to understand the company structure, the company goals, and understand what the value is. Now, you will notice that the last bullet says do this on your own. Don't go asking questions, interviewing, reading. Sit back and reflect on the company. Depending on the amount of time that you've been in a company, you will be able to get its zen, get its essence. When I say that understand the company structure, it goes beyond the organizational food chain. Because we all know that there is a vice president of finance, and we also know that there is a CFO under that vice president of finance, and we also know that there is two controllers under that. But let me assure you, nobody's getting a paycheck unless the second controller says issue a paycheck. That's not reflected in the organizational structure. And you need to know that, because that affects your conversation in developing a cybersecurity program. You need to know where the centers of gravity are. And organizational structures tend to be abstract and very pretty when done with Visio, but they don't necessarily reflect the reality that Mary has the power, and unless Mary says yes, nothing happens in here. That's the organizational structure that is important to understand when you're developing a product. And that is why you need to do this in relative isolation. You need to trust yourself in the process of doing that. And remember that you're not trying to conduct an audit. You know, this is a review. This is a journey of discovery. Enjoy this journey of discovery. Now, the 800-pound gorilla with a corresponding definition. Company culture is everything. Everything. And this is can be a tremendous benefit, a fuel to your success and to the organization's success, or a tremendous impediment. You need to understand company culture and work with a company culture because, again, as per Drucker, culture will lead strategy for lunch any time of the day. Believe it. By the way, if Drucker was collecting royalties for every time that some speaker was using his one-liners, he'd be a gazillionaire by now. Okay? So, but this is true. This thing is absolutely true. Culture will eat strategy for lunch every single day. So you need to understand that. And use a cultural assessment survey. This is great stuff. And there's a reference here about Cameron and Roberts' work, and it is just really extraordinarily useful. I particularly like the dimensions of the thing. If you notice the dimensions, first of all, it's ranking six dimensions, right? Dominant characteristics, leadership, management, glue, which is a collegial glue, strategy and success. And then it ranks these things are personal versus controlling, nurturing versus results-oriented, conformity, teamwork versus conformity, trusting versus policing, humanistic versus efficiency first, and people-centric versus company success. I can guarantee you, just by reading this paragraph, at least three quarters of you already pegged your company in this. Am I right? I imagine that you know exactly if your company is people-centric versus company success, or humanistic or not, because you can tell. No program will ever succeed. No cybersecurity program, no any other kind of program is ever going to succeed in a company that if this program is going against culture. If your company is freewheeling, entrepreneurial, and is going out there and it is like, woohoo, you know, fail many times, party on, we have, you know, a fish tank, make it happen. And you try to say, well, you're going to have, you know, an 18-character password associated with a token key and biometrics, otherwise you're not getting on your computer. Mm. Good luck with that. See how far that goes. On the other hand, you're in a company and everybody walks in goose step every morning. You try to say, hey, password, schmassword, it's dead anyway. I'm going to, like, get you through your behavioral footprint. Your job is probably something you need to evaluate. It doesn't fit with the culture. So you have a couple of choices here. Choice number one, which is very difficult, is for you to assess the culture and then work with that information to balance it. You may have to do some shifting. You may have to do some accepting. Choice number two, leave. But, as I said earlier, you risk people. You're my kids. You're not in this gig because it's easy. You're in this gig because you do it very, very well. And this is one of the tools that's going to enable you to do it even better. Now, again, I'll keep putting my $5 to Peter Drucker, okay? Nothing worse than doing well for something that shouldn't be done. Part of understanding the culture and part of understanding what it is that you're trying to achieve as a company, framing it in the vision and mission statements, is trying to do all of this. The how do you define success part becomes probably the most important metric. And I don't know if any of you know about the example of Bismarck. Bismarck is considered to be the father of modern Germany. So back in old Germany, Germany was a fragmented mess of little kingdoms and baronets and all that kind of stuff. So, you know, this cat Otto says, nine, I'm going to bring everything together, we'll make Germany. I have a plan. It's like, okay, Otto, let's go. So Otto goes out and, you know, Otto does his Otto thing, and don't you know, a few years later, you have Germany. And Germany has destroyed all of its enemies, and you know, they're running heavy and they're unbelievable, and they're this and they're that and they're the other. And all of his advisors are going up to him and saying, man, you rock! Let's go get the rest of Europe. France looks ready. Okay? And Otto turned around and said, nein, our goal was to make Germany a country. We made Germany a country, ergo, we succeeded. Goal reached. Now hang out and govern. This is a very important lesson. And I'm Greek, by the way, I'm not German, in case you figure that out. Yeah. So there's not particularly love lost with Otto. So, in any event, this is an important thing for everybody to understand. Understanding what success is and when to stop is just as important of knowing when to start and what cultural shifts you have to put in place. Strategy, steering, and standards, earlier speakers spoke at length about this, and this is just absolutely critical. Now, alignment has to do with everything else, bringing these strategies, steering, and standards in alignment with your competencies, conditions, conduct, and capabilities. And you are going to need to understand both of those. Because if you don't have alignment, you're not creating value. Remember the no money, no mission? Same thing here. No alignment, no value. Means what? What does it mean to me? I'm doing a cybersecurity program. What does it mean to me? Really, realistically. It means that if your cybersecurity program is not aligned with all of the above, the strategy, the culture, the way that the organization is being governed, all of these minutiae is going to fall on its face with a big thud. To avoid that. So this is why this is very important to understand. Now, this is not a conversation about frameworks. I am partial. I have a COVID thing. My name is Chris, and I'm a COVID aficionado. Now, as it happens, COVID and NIST work very, very well together. So my personal preference, COVID and NIST, hands down. I know there's people that swear by ISO, and I know that there can be many a religious conversation about frameworks. My two cents on the frameworks, part of why I'm such a huge fan of both COVID and NIST is because of its inherent wisdom. They're very smart, they're comprehensive, they're flexible, but I find, of all things, I find COVID very specifically to be very wise because it recognizes that one size does not fit all. And it recognizes that you can cherry pick whatever it is that you want from it and apply it to your own environment. And that is wisdom. So that's my two cents. Again, no religious conversations. Assets. I define assets as anything of value, and this is important. If it's worth it to you, it's an asset. And if it's worth it to you, you can rest assured that it's worth to someone else. I'm going to skip the data versus information bit because I'm going to come back to it. Data, hardware, software, processes, workflows, and systems, all of these lovely things are assets. And there are no people on that list. Why? Because you must always be able to identify an owner of an asset. And thankfully, in 2016, we don't have people owners anymore. Still. Yet. Now, data versus information. I said earlier I'm a physicist, and we got to get some things straight. It's a personal pet peeve. I'm sorry I'm wasting your time, but get to know it. Information is everything and anything. A classic example of information is a cosmic ray that's hurtling through space right now. It's going to go right through the planet. That is information. It's not data. That's information. People are using the word information to mean data. To mean structured information or captured information, that's data. So if you really want to look smart, tell people that information is the cosmic ray. And they go, what? No. That's why it's, as I said, it's not you, it's me. You can keep using information as you like it. So when I go in and I have these conversations with these business units and the different companies and trying to do all that kind of stuff, I never mention COVID. I never mention this. I never mention any framework. I sit down, roll up my sleeves, sitting next to them, and say, listen, Chuck, this is what I need to know. I need to know 10 things about these assets. Who's the owner? Okay? Who's the custodian? And you just can't tell me, oh, the custodian is ID. No, that doesn't work. No, specifics. Custodian is who? Bob. Okay, good. What's Bob's title? Get his number. Get specific when you're getting into these kinds of things. Abstracts don't work when we're talking cybersecurity programs. Get specific. Location. Where's Waldo? I mean, if you have 25,000 offices all over the world, I need to know each one of them. Classifications. These are my favorite. You can use your own. I use 1 through 4. And I try to stay consistent across all of the stuff because, as I will explain in 30 seconds, these are nested spreadsheets. And when you're using nested spreadsheets and doing this kind of asset classification work, if you're staying consistent across your rankings, then all of these spreadsheets can be linked with one another, and then you can have hours of uninterrupted fun sorting and prioritizing and doing all sorts of stuff. It's great stuff, okay? The rest of the stuff I figured, you know, NTD, RPO, RTO, and resources, my favorite. And a lot of people vapor walk on you when you start saying resources. It is absolutely critical that you identify the resources necessary for the life of the asset. What does it come? Who do you need to bring this thing back to life? Who do you need to make sure that this thing is staying alive all the time? Okay? This is an example of the spreadsheet. Now, as I said earlier, it's all about engagement. Our goal is to engage people. So in this particular case, when I do this, I let them handle this stuff. I am sitting next to them to provide the guidance, but I want them to own this stuff. That way, they're A, very proud of what they're doing, and B, very truthful. Why? Because it matters to them. It really matters to them when you are classifying the things of value that is to them. And this is a beautiful thing. That's the goal. Now, when I'm talking about recursion, is the thing that we're talking about the spreadsheets, right? This stuff keeps going in and in and in and in and in. And all of a sudden, because, again, like, okay, dramatic pause. You're talking about a business unit. When you're talking to a business unit, say accounting, you're not going to be talking about the server asset in accounting. No, you're going to be talking about the accounts payable system. That's the asset. So the business owner of that asset is not going to know which server this stupid thing is sitting on. He's not going to know anything about this. This is the asset. It's very valuable. If we don't have it, we don't pay people. Bad. So this is the stuff that matters to them. By using recursion now, you can now go and say accounts payable contains bada 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 bada. All of those bada bada badas are assets, which you can now find asset owners for. And you can ask them, hey, what about this server? You get the idea. Now, threats. I explained the threats because here the threats are slightly different than the earlier conversation about landscape. This now starts getting very specific to them. And I leave this part for last. Because it's true. And we as professionals tend to be a little bit on the paranoid side, and that's a good thing. I mean, we get paid to be a little paranoid. But by explaining to people what's going on out there, you start clarifying the level of paranoia, because somebody's going to look at, you know, a cyber terrorist, and he's going to say, this is just not going to happen in my world. It's not part of my world. It's not relevant. I don't have to look at this threat. And this is a huge relief if you don't have to look at this threat. Now, we've seen this before, but a lot of Anissa's work, and this is the most recent poster thing on Anissa, and part of the things that are highlighted here in red are currently what's going on in that world. I'm not going to go into details or the technicalities about risk modeling, systems that support it, and so on and so forth. The one that I've been fascinated with, again, I tend to be a big aficionado of things that are flexible. Octave is very flexible, and it comes also in light versions, and so I kind of like that kind of stuff. But in using the framework of pragmatism, what is pragmatic? We're talking about risk intelligence and trying to manage risk information. And again, excuse the language, get yourself a kick-ass CN system. Typically as a cloud would be nice, or in-house, but a good Fed intelligence Fed CN is absolutely key. I would much prefer having in place a great CN system than having a medium IPS or even a fair IDS. Seems better in my view of the world. Okay? Very important, because for the first time, if you get the systems that are intelligent enough, you are not going to be drowning in the logs. You are going to be getting meaningful, actionable information, which is going to make your job easier. Needless to say, this last part is not part of the conversation that's happening with business, with business people in the room. You start talking about seeing with business people in the room, they're going to tar and feather you out of the organization. Now, this is an ISACA meeting. This is the mandatory ISACA slide. If you don't put the ISACA slide on, you are expelled from the organization. I don't know if you knew that. Oh yeah, so when you're invited to talk, you don't have the ISACA slide on. You remember the other guys have two ISACA slides. So it means you probably screwed up in your opinion. That's just saying. Okay, the pragmatic component. Remember this, please. Okay, not all threats are relevant. Stick with what's relevant to you. If you start spewing off threats and statistics and numbers to an organization that whose threats are not relevant to them, you're going to get the glazing again. You don't want glazing. You want this thing to stay real for that. So, vulnerabilities. My favorite folks at NIST. Hey, what happened? Stay there. Where are we? Oh, here we are. What did you say? Oh yeah, plenty of time. We can certainly talk about the election. So, the election? Yes, anyway.
New information service today. On the prior slide, you had the 40% for the insider.
Yeah.
Is that possible that 40% of these companies
It is. And it's climbing. The insider threat is climbing. Now, insider threat, the definition is also expanding. And it's a very complicated picture, and it happens to be particularly delicious. Why? Because an insider threat now is not just the disgruntled employee that says, I'm going to get them. Now you have situations where you have actual extortion. So you have third parties extorting employees to get access, because remember, as we say in physics, things are going to go in the easiest possible way in. The path of least resistance is always going to apply on everything, in cybersecurity too. So if I can compromise this guy to get his credentials for me to get in, I don't have to fight 25 firewalls and 5 goons trying to go through the door. I can compromise this guy, he's already in.
No.
That's right. And you can use them as a tool in a variety of ways. They're disgruntled, they can be extorted, or they can find themselves in a very, very bad time in their life. And frequently we have had cases where you have spouses that are very sick and they have to raise money in order to deal with medical care. Children, similar situation. Refugees, you can have a very complex picture that causes somebody to become vulnerable. And the controls for insider threats, by the way, are very different than your average controls that we're going to talk about a little bit down the line. The insider threat controls are far more complex because you're dealing with people, you're dealing with humans. So you have to be extraordinarily careful, and part of the sensitizing of the whole organization about your cybersecurity stance is explaining to everybody in the organization that this is a threat, it's a real threat, and you need to be aware of it. And all of a sudden, if you start seeing an employee, a colleague, above you, below you, sideways, that are starting to act abnormally, you need to bring it to somebody's attention. And part one of the most successful controls is employee awareness for insider threats. Back in this. There you go. And this was out of what? Oh, this is old news. This is October 3rd. So if you go and check this today, you get the picture. The stuff is enormous and increasing. Now, where were we? In the village.
Yes.
Past Corona Village. There you go, there's another slide. So, the vulnerability slide that we saw earlier, that are the classic vulnerabilities that we're dealing with in information technology and cybersecurity, are all fine and good. As we know, the Internet of Things component has changed the landscape quite dramatically. And most recently, the attacks have been pronounced that this is a vector that is going to take an enormous amount of prominence. How this affects your organization will vary. You could be downstream of an IoT attack that may affect your organization and you may not even know it. And that's something that you're going to have to take into account as you plan out a cybersecurity program. Namely, if DNS servers go out and you're dark, you don't care about the fact that it is not your organization that was hit, but it was, you know, part of the overall infrastructure that was hit. So all of this becomes very important. At CSX 2016, there was several tracks on the IoT and cybersecurity and the statistics and the ease whereby these kinds of hacks happening now is alarming. I mean, all of the things that you have been hearing about it, how easy it is, obsolete code, non-protected, da-da-da-da-da-da, all that kind of stuff is true. In one of the keynote addresses, which was by a hacker, by the way, he actually demoed it live, you know, at CSX. The guy says, turn off the cameras, let's show you something. Boom. See? Simple. And indeed, very, very simple and very, very scary stuff. So, things that I use when we go in and start explaining to people as the program is unfolding. The difference between penetration tests and vulnerability testing is very important for people to understand. How it is that if it's worth it to do a penetration test, if it's worth it to do a vulnerability test, if all of these things line up with their threat perception. We have had clients, more than one, that really didn't want to do this, didn't want to engage in these kinds of tests, which is crazy. So, and that was because their threat perception was not aligned with the appropriate use of the metrics that are going to come out of these kinds of tools. Vulnerability testing. Remember the assessment that we did earlier? If that is done right, then vulnerability tests become way easier. Because the first thing that a third-party vendor is going to do is going to take this as an input. If you have done your job right, and the BI people have done their job right, and all of that has been done correctly, this step becomes piece of cake. And this is part of the reason why all of these things, all of that homework needs to be done correctly, because it minimizes cost and makes life easier for everybody. Obviously, you cannot test for a zero-day vulnerability. Obviously. That's why they call it zero-day. But you can put things around it in order to make sure that you're protected from it or mitigate as much as possible. You're this far away from happy hour. Okay. We're almost there. We're going to plow through this relatively quickly. One of the things that I try to explain to people when we go through this process together and building a cybersecurity program together, remember the togetherness bit is key, is understanding what controls are all about. The word controls has been thrown about a little bit too much. This thing is moving. Stop it. And the easiest way to explain this to somebody is that controls do stuff. You will know that something is a control by your ability to answer that question. Does it do anything? If it does something, it's a control. If it doesn't do anything, it's not a control. It may be useful, but it's not a control. So one of the obvious questions immediately when it comes to that is like, how about my cyber insurance? Is that a control? Is it a control? As a requirement, but you correctly said it's not a control. That's right, it's a requirement, and there will be a lot of those. Depending on what kind of industry you're at, you may have a lot of requirements to comply, but not all of them are controls. So, this is how I explain the different sets of controls to people that are not professionals in the field, that are business people. They need to understand it in order, in ways that make sense to them, that they resonate with them. Road barriers is a way that a preventive control resonates with a business owner, or with an executive team, or with a board of directors. Because what I do, when you have all of the classifications of the controls, you're going to create some sort of a chart that says, this is my spend on this, this is my spend on that, this is how much I spend on prevention, this is how much I spend on detection, and this is why. And you are going to have to explain it in a way that makes sense to them. This is how much I'm going to spend on making road barriers, okay? This is how much I'm going to spend on motion sensors. This is how much I'm going to spend on having a paramedic team ready. And this is how much I'm going to spend when all else goes to hell, part of controls. And that becomes very important. Now, one of the things that I always say, and I try to take as much advantage of popular culture as possible, is I try to use things like popular movies, things like from the news, in order to make something relatable. So when I start talking about defense in depth, that is something that a lot of business owners are just going to glaze over you very, very quickly. What do you mean defense in depth? What does it mean? How is it relevant to my organization? Are we overspending? What is this all about? By the way, defense in depth has recently been gaining some fairly interesting controversial press, okay? And the press that's been getting less controversial is along the lines of like, you know, you're talking defense in depth, all money. Now everything's on the cloud, half the employees are working from home, you know, I got storage there, I'm consuming 10,000 services from all over the planet. What defense in depth? You know, there's no more defense in depth. It's like, not so fast, Kimasabi. Because defense in depth is not about the concept of having a castle and a moat. This is not defense in depth. Defense in depth doesn't mean that I have multiple layers of controls in my castle, which is physically located at the corner of 53rd and Lex. That's not defense of depth in depth. Defense in depth is looking at the assets and defending the asset with this kind of strategy. I don't care where the asset lives. I don't care if it's in the cloud. I don't care if it's in Timbuktu. Defense in depth needs to apply to the asset irrespective of where and how it is. And it needs to apply with some degree of measure in terms of its life cycle, which is another very important thing and frequently missed. So, Anna, Anna, wrote a beautiful book on software project management, and I have pilfered this line from her. And I try to explain to people the difference between understanding complex and complicated. And this is how Anna explains it beautifully. You have the difference between shoveling snow, building an IKEA desk, and performing heart surgery. Okay? Shoveling snow is labor. You get out, you hate it, you shovel snow, you go back to bed. Building an IKEA desk is complex. You sit there, you spend your afternoon trying to build this stupid desk, and it doesn't work because some screw is missing and the whole thing, you know the drill. Doing heart surgery is complicated. Did I just reverse those? Yes. Thank you. Thank you. The other way, right? So putting the IKEA desk together is complicated. Doing heart surgery is complex. And this is my favorite quote when I try to explain to people about cybersecurity, because after you go through this exercise, the next thing that happens is like, okay, so we're going to blow X number of thousands of dollars, we're going to put these people together, we're going to put these processes together, I'm going to have the red team, and I'm going to have the blue team, and I'm going to do the simulations, and I'm going to pay a third-party vendor to do the pen tests and all that kind of stuff, and when I'm done, I will be safe. No, you won't be safe. What do you mean? I mean that line. And I paraphrase from The Martian. People have seen The Martian? Remember that line?
Yes.
That's exactly right. So I'm not going to leave. Because if you are in our profession, everything will go south. There's no question. No question about it. What we need to do, what our duty is to make sure that when it does, We got to do the right work for it. Now, process. It is absolutely critical as part of your assessment in engaging with the people in the organization and trying to put everything together, developing this program, is to understand their capacity as an organization in terms of internalizing, absorbing, and digesting what it is that you're saying. What do I mean by that? If you have a college student that is in a third-year calculus program, she is capable of solving differential equations, understanding integrals, life is good. She owns calculus. If you have her talk to her little sister about calculus, and the little sister happens to be in elementary school, it is completely not okay to call the little sister dumb, because she doesn't know calculus. And of course, everybody in the room says, well, yeah, Merry Christmas, this is absurd. It's not. This is maturity level. Straight up. Straight up maturity level. You go into an organization, if the organization doesn't have the capacity, the maturity, to understand what is needed in a cybersecurity program, if they are CMMI 2, don't even try. You need to raise the maturity level first. Just the way you need to deal with the cultural issues, you need to raise the maturity issues as well. It is very, these are showstoppers. And whose job is it to figure that out? It's your job to figure it out. Because you are going to be the agents of change. You're putting all these things together. You are the puppet masters in a way. Because you have the skills and the knowledge necessary to understand. It's like, oh, I'm going to be barking up that wrong tree if I try to do this now. Because the organization is not ready. I'm not even going to try. That battle is not worth fighting because you will lose it. It's calculus. The elementary school kid. It's not going to work. Train the kid up first. So, what I need you to be is the conductor, not the expert soloist that you already are. I have no doubt about that. Within your individual narrow world, you are a great soloist. Part of the shift that I'm asking you and your organizations to engage in is to start seeing this whole thing as an orchestra. And I want you to be the conductor. You understand the music. You understand all of the nuances. But I want you to be the conductor. You can ask, well, who, little me in audit? I'm going to be the conductor? Uh-huh, yeah, you in audit. You in cybersecurity. You in the trenches of IT. You, the newly appointed CISO, you are going to be the conductor. You can take that role on, okay? As you formalize all this and all doing this, some things that you should always include is a sense of reason. Why does this matter? Why is this important? Why in God's name does this make sense for me to do this? In all of your communications, in all of your engagements, if you make it a policy, if you make it a standard to explain that, to include why this makes sense, people are not dumb. People are going to read this and say, that sort of kind of makes sense. Yeah, I get it. I'm going to do that. This is part of the engagement process, part of the cultural shift, is this proactive communication component. I trust you've seen this. If not, go get it. It's great stuff. It really is great stuff. This is NIST process diagram, by the way. It is great. And by the way, a gentleman that was part of the NIST development team was at CSX 2016, which you all promised to show up at 2017 because it's very good. He said that those gears that you see all the way to the left of the slide actually are what? If you notice, the gears cannot possibly work the way they are configured. And he said that they are about to release a new diagram and those gears will actually work. They promised to do that. which is very, very sweet. But of course, my addiction problem. Pretty, no? Very precious. So, I assume that everybody understands the COVID cycle here. And most people, when they look at that, the first place that they go to is the numeral number one that says what are the drivers. And that, of course, makes a lot of sense. That's why it has the numeral number one. But you will notice that it has a whole set of concentric rings. And when it comes into a cybersecurity program, because these things are not happening in isolation, because these things are happening in living systems in organizations, by the way, big parenthesis here, organizations are not living things. People are living things. We'll get to that in a minute. I always start from the innermost ring. The innermost ring says, recognize the need to act. Why do I go there? Because we all of us, are in that spot. That's the spot where we are at. The organization and all sorts of processes and this, that, and the other, and all those beautiful things may be at numeral number one. Where we are is in this spot. Recognize the need to act. Now, why are we doing this? Because irrespective of what business you're in, we are in the people business. This is what it is that we are protecting. This is what we're doing this about. Organizations don't create value. People create value. Organizations don't vote, with some minor exceptions. But you get the idea. Organizations are constructs. The things that we are engaged in every day, and we tend to mistrust, we tend to disconnect this. We work for a bank. No, you don't work for a bank. You're a group of people trying to get together and perform a certain set of services. It's always about the people, okay? Value is created by and for people. This is not a populist statement. This is not a political statement. It's a matter of fact. It is by and for people. Cybersecurity, risk, audit, IT, and the list is long. We're in the service of these people. Don't lose track of this. We are in healthcare. Look at it that way. We are in healthcare, and each one of us occupies a role in this healthcare ecosystem. We got the surgeons, we got the ENTs, we got the cardiologists, we got the cancer people, we got the internists, we got nurses. This is us. But what we do is we create healthy organisms. Only now we call them organizations. Skills are not enough. Skills are not going to be enough. If you don't have the right language to communicate and engage with other people, you're not going anywhere. You can be the best cardiologist on the planet. You're going to find yourself isolated in some dark room. And only in the direst of circumstances, somebody's going to pull you out of the room to do heart surgery and pull you right back into the room. If that's the kind of life that you want to lead, okay. But that's not the only thing that you need to do. Language is not enough. Speaking is not communicating. Listening is communicating. So going up to a meeting and barking off a presentation and saying, and now that I have concluded, please fork over $3,868.14 in order for me to buy this toy. That's not going to fly. Okay? It's all part of an active engagement and active listening. Peter Drucker again, another $5. Management is doing things right. Leadership is doing the right things. So, you know where you are. You can smell the beer outside. Bring it all together. Cybersecurity is not once and done. It's a continuous process. It is a journey. It's a journey that, by hook or crook, it's a calling that we have adopted, and this is what it is that we do. It is our duty and our responsibility to go out and engage other people in order to be mutually successful. We cannot do this alone. The three words for everybody to remember in case you've missed it. People, people, people. This is what it is all about. Don't forget that. So, what is cybersecurity? That ain't it. That ain't it either. This is cybersecurity. Thank you. Any questions? Thank you very much. Enjoy your day.